Thank you very much for coming. Hope you had a nice lunch. And yeah, thank you for having me, PyData. It's really great to be here. So my name is Justina, or also you can call me Juste if you prefer. I work as a developer advocate at Raza, and what I do there, I really focus on open source side of what Raza does in terms of conversational AI, and I really truly care about the open source community. Today, I'm going to talk about AI assistants and how you can use machine learning to build assistants that scale in production. Let's start with, in general, like, why do we care about chatbots and why they are useful? It's getting really hard to surprise people with AI assistants and chatbots these days because, well, let's be honest, they are becoming a big part of our daily lives, and especially after big companies like Google announced their Google Duplex, probably it's hard to find a person that have never heard of AI assistant. Despite of all the hype and attention that AI assistants get, the techniques that are being used to develop AI assistants are still quite limited because majority of developers, they still use techniques like state machines or rule-based approaches to build AI assistants. But in fact, there are quite a few criteria, as I would say, that a good assistant should have and that developers should keep in mind when developing ones. So first of all, an assistant has to be able to generalize on a lot of different users because, well, we as humans, we are complicated creatures and we speak in so many different ways, and there are so many different ways how two different people can say exactly the same thing. So a good assistant has to be able to generalize on these different inputs. And another kind of criteria is that AI assistant has to be able to learn from user feedback and ideally to learn from the mistakes the assistant makes. So for example, if a user provides some additional details about the query, an assistant should be able to pick up those details and either correct themselves or to to learn more about what the user is asking. So these are just one of the challenges that Raza is trying to solve, and as a result, Raza developed two open source libraries, which creates Raza Stack as a framework for building conversational AI. And this stack consists of two libraries. First one is Raza NLU, which is a library for natural language understanding. So it's something you would use to train the assistant to understand what the user means. Another part is a library called Raza Core, which is a machine learning based dialogue management. And it's something, as a developer, you would use to enable your assistant to predict what action or what response an assistant should give back to the user based on a specific state of the conversation. And again, everything is open source, and everything is based on machine learning. So we are going to see how that works. Here is the overall architecture of how an assistant built with Raza NLU and Raza Core would work. So, for example, we have a user that is asking, for example, what's the weather like tomorrow? And the first stage that this message goes through is a connector module. Here, you can use pretty much any messaging platform or voice interface that you would like to use, or even your custom app. Then the message is being passed to input module, so-called ears, and this is what Raza NLU does here. So it takes those unstructured user inputs, it extracts necessary information that helps an assistant to understand what the user said, and then it passes all these details to dialogue management, so-called brain, and this is where Raza Core stands. It takes all the details that NLU model extracted, and it predicts how an assistant should respond. And those responses can be a lot of different things. It can be simple text response, or it can be some backend integration. So for example, an assistant can connect to the database and extract some data and use that to create the output, or it can be an API call, so a lot of different things. And then all these details are being used to create the response. Here you would use output module, so-called mouth. Since RAS is open source, again, you have a variety of options here. You can use either some NLG algorithms here, or you can use UI elements like buttons. It really depends on the architecture of your assistant. And then everything is being sent to connector module, because this is how the user gets the message back or the voice message back. And then an assistant could respond with like something, it will be sunny and 20 degrees, something that a user can understand. So this is actually what this entire workshop is going to be about. And my goal today is to show you how you can build an assistant using machine learning. I hope that those who are going to follow will have an assistant running on your local machine. Since there are quite a lot of steps, quite a few, in the development, that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to cover what is under the hood for each stage. So I will start with the NLU part. Explain the algorithms, what's under the hood, then we will dive into code, dialogue handling, the same, and I will also talk a little about how you can close the feedback loop and how you can improve an assistant using those user feedback details that I mentioned previously. And I will make sure to leave some time for questions. Let's see how that goes. So what I'm going to use, I'm using a Jupyter notebook, and I will be running this on Python 3.6. Other versions should work also, but I'm a little bit afraid of saying that it also works with Python 3.7, just because I think TensorFlow still has some issues with making it compatible with some TensorFlow and Python 3.6 as a library. So I would suggest Python 3.6. And this is the repository that I'm going to use. So you have still some time to get it. I will keep this URL in upcoming slides, so you have some time to set everything up and just basically clone the repository and have the notebooks on your machine. I will explain later the entire workflow, how I'm going to work with this. So I will start with natural language understanding and what is under the hood. So again, the URL for the repository will be at the bottom of the slides. So the main idea and the main goal of natural language understanding in chatbots and AI assistants is to enable an assistant to understand unstructured user input. So when a user asks a question or says something, so for example, here I have an example when a user wants to change an address after they moved, the goal is to build a model which will extract structured data from this input. In RASA NLU, this structured input consists of two parts. One is what is the overall intention of the sentence. So for example, if someone wants to change the address, the intention is it can be address change. So a model should be able to classify this input as, for example, address change. And another part of this structured data is entity, or it can be a bunch of entities, which are pieces of information that helps an assistant to understand specifically what the user said, and also helps to extract specific details that an assistant can use to later make specific responses or take actions. So for example, here, if a user already said that their new address is 709 King Street, San Francisco, it would be good for the assistant to extract this information so that it can later use this piece of information to make action or do something with it. So how that works under the hood? So again, everything is based on machine learning. And there are quite a few ways how RASA deals with natural language understanding. One of them is using word vectors. The way the process, overall process looks like is that when the assistant gets a user input, it goes through vectorization stage, which means that we look up the vectors for each token in a sentence, and then we build a classifier that predicts the label of the intention of the sentence. How that works, even more under the hood. So Bag of words are your best friends here. When a user asks a question, this question is tokenized into words. Then you can use word vectors, as I have mentioned, and you have options to use spacey, glove vectors, or also fast text is a really good source of word vectors to use. And then when you look up vectors for each of the word, you have to create the representation of entire sentence. By default, Rasa takes the average of these word vectors, and that's how the sentence representation is created. And then this sentence representation, alongside the label of example input, is being used to train the model. Default model in Rasa NLU is a support vector machine, so it works as a multi-class classification problem. So if you in your training data you have 5 different intentions, so what a user could ask, then if you will pass a new input, the model will try to predict, it will do its best to predict one of these labels.
Are you using your own model, like saved off, like WordDevec model, or you can let people bring in their own WordDevec model?
Yeah, so you can use something that is by default, that is implemented, but again, since Rasa NLU is open source, you are completely free to implement your own models and use that. That's the feature that I like the most about Rasa, that you can customize everything. You can see all the code, and you can play around, and you can change the models and use something that you build yourself.
How do you deal with sentence length? I mean, if you're vectorizing, you can't just bag of words.
What do you mean?
Never mind. It's okay.
We can chat after, maybe.
Yeah, she's hitting the average.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
Oh, she's
And the next stage is entity extraction. So it is a little deeper process, but it's still quite similar to intent classification if you use word vectors. So the entire sentence is tokenized again into words. And then you can use Path of Speech Tagger to look up the grammatical meaning of the word. Is it a noun, verb, adjective, and so on. We have a chunker. So some entities, for example, addresses, they might consist of more than one word. So it's important to train the model that would be able to extract those type of entities as well as an entire chunk as one entity. So this is what chunker is for. And then you train the named entity recognition model. And the result of the model is entity extraction. And you get the entity itself, the value, and the label of that entity. So for example, here as an example was about the weather again. So the entity in the sentence is tomorrow, because an assistant should know for which day it should report the weather. So the type of this entity would be date and the value tomorrow. Again, how this works under the hood, there are two ways of doing that. So one of them is to use two classifiers. One first classify if there is an entity in a sentence or not, and then use another classifier to predict the value of the entity. Probably better and I would say easier approach is to use direct structured prediction when you use one model to do both, to look for entity in a sentence and predict the value of that sentence and the label. By default, again, Rasa NLU is using conditional random fields. So it's an algorithm which works in a very similar way as SkipGram model when you use surrounding words to predict the target word and what kind of label that word would have. But there are some limitations even with that. Even though you can probably build quite a good model with pre-trained word vectors, and in some situations that's something I would suggest using, but the main limitation is that if you use approach, as I showed before, then you can have only one label for one user input. The problem is that, again, we humans and our speech is complicated, and when we send, for example, a text message to a friend, sometimes this one sentence can have more than one meaning. And, well, it's quite limiting. What Raza tried to do, and I think it does quite successfully now, is it came up with a different approach to build intent classification models so that it wouldn't use any pre-trained word vectors, so that it would be able to predict more than one intention in a sentence. So, for example, here, like if someone says, "Cool, who is the mayor of New York City?" That it would assign the state of the person that they are happy, and they would also like to know some additional information about New York City or something like that. The way it does all this is that it this task is called supervised word vectors, and it's called the new way of doing NLU. So it's inspired by Facebook research and inspired by a paper called Starspace. So the main idea is that this model is a ranking model. So you create an embedding for both message and all the intents that you have in your training data. And then you calculate the similarity between the new sentence that is provided by the user and all the intents. And the goal is to optimize the loss function, which I'm pretty sure is using softmax here. So it works a lot better in specific domains, and the main advantage is that if you are building an assistant in a very, very specific domain, you probably will not have word vectors for some of the vocabulary words, and this is a good advantage of that. Also, since you don't need pre-trained word vectors, that means you can build assistants in any language you want. Well, any language you can tokenize. Yeah, I can see the question.
Yeah, sorry if I missed this, but in your examples, it seemed like there were two sentences in each of the bodies of text on the previous slide.
Mm-hmm.
And it seemed like the classification is kind of broken down by that. Could you just clarify, are you treating those as like two separate bags of words then?
Yeah, in a way. So during the training, for example, here, greet and don't care are then treated as tokens. So this example would then be used to train the intent greet as well as don't care. And it will also learn to identify if those two intentions happened in one user input, that is actually a multi-intent, that those two labels should be assigned to this input.
So the punctuation is treated as a boundary there.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you will see that in a code.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Cool. So that's the introduction to NLU and what is happening under the hood. I think now we can try and code something. So let's see. So at first, I will just explain a little what is happening in this repo. So I have three Jupyter notebooks. And I'm actually going to do really, really live demo here, and I will try to code an assistant live. So who knows what can happen, but if you want to if you want to follow along, please do. And for this, I will use a notebook called Workshop Starter. But if you would like to see the code that is already completed and just follow along and catch the typos that I'm going to make, you can use either Workshop Completed that has all the code, or Workshop Executed, which has all the code and executed cells, so that you can see the output already. And all the other files here, they are either the outputs of some of the cells or something that I'm going to use, but I'm going to explain as I go. Great. So let's start. I will explain what we are going to build. We are going to build an assistant that is going to be able to recommend research papers for the person that is really anxious about something interesting, but they are really not happy maybe with how the website interface works or something like that. So it's going to consist of a few stages, as I said, NLU, dialog management, and then user feedback. But let's get started with setting things up. So this cell here is just an introductory cell. It doesn't really have to do much with NLU or dialog management yet. This is just basically for debugging. I'm using logging to see the output of the cells better, in, especially if I make any mistakes somewhere. And I'm just turning off some warnings just to make things cleaner here. And I have a pretty print function, which is going to be used to simply print the JSON output in a nice and formatted way. So I'm going to run this, and then I have installation of Rasa Stack. So for this workshop, I'm going to only use basically three libraries, Rasa NLU, Rasa Core, and sklearn CRF Suite. I will run this. It should not take too long. I already did that. One disclaimer, I know that some people had some issues installing, so I think that is because there are some issues with using virtual environment and installing Rasa and Leon Core. So if you have something like that, I would suggest, and if you want to follow, I would suggest just simply installing them locally for now. But I will look into what are the problems with this. Just quickly check. Okay, so I have that, and just for the sake of knowing that it all works well, I will check the versions that I have. So that's what I should get. 13.6 of NLU and Core 11.11. Again, Rasa NLU and Core are under heavy development. There are so many things that are being improved, so it's better if you use the same versions. And this one is a GraphViz. It's an optional library that you can use for Windows users. Unfortunately, it's a really difficult installation. So if you get errors there, please don't stress about it, because I think PyGraphViz doesn't have extensions for Windows, unfortunately. So I will show you the output, and I hope that everyone else can make them work somehow. But they are a bit stubborn libraries to install. Great. Without further ado, let's dive in natural language understanding. So as I said, we are building an assistant to find and recommend research papers for the user. So if a user would like to find some interesting statistics-related papers or machine learning-related papers, so that a chatbot would be able to do so. The first thing that you have to do when you try to build a machine learning model, you need training data. Now, when it comes to conversational AI, training data is a big problem because you can't just go on the web and find conversations written by someone that you can reuse. So there are a few approaches you can take, one of them that I prefer, if you have no training data to get started, is just play a little game. Pretend that you are a bot and ask your friend to ask you questions, so that as you would answer them as if you were a bot. And it helps in a few ways. You're going to validate the idea of your assistant, like, does it even make sense to build an assistant for this kind of thing? You will also test if maybe some tasks that you would like your assistant to complete are too difficult. So if you are going to struggle, an assistant probably will struggle as well. And also you will generate some training data. And that's exactly what I did. I wrote two conversations that I would have with my bot if I had one, or if I will build one. So one conversation goes like, I say hello, a chatbot says, hey, how can I help? And then I ask for papers about mathematics. A chatbot finds something and asks if I would like to get the link, and I say yes, of course, and the bot sends me a link, and happy days. Both are happy. And another possible conversation that I could have with an assistant is that I ask for any type of paper at first. So for assistant to know what kind of paper to suggest me, it should probably ask what kind of a paper I'm interested in. So I provide that information. For example, here I'm interested in physics, and then assistant looks for physics papers, and then I also ask additional information, for example, what are the authors of the paper and so on, and assistant provides these details. So you have to cover in your training data at least few possible conversation turns to train the model. Now let's go ahead and write some training data for NLU model. NLU model training data consists of intents, so those intentions of what the user might say, and examples, like actual conversational examples, how a user would say these specific things. So I'm going to start with simply going through these conversations and writing some of them. So I will start maybe with conversation number two, because it's something you can see on the screen. So, a user started conversation with hi. So, what is the intention of this input? It's probably greeting. So I'm going to define the label of this intent, and it works like that. So I write intent, and then I just simply write the intent label. I will call it greet. It's really up to the developer to decide what the intent label should be. And now I have to provide the actual example of how user would say hi. So just like that, I type this hi message here. Now let's take a look further. So a bot responded, hello, how can I help? And then a user asked, I'm looking for interesting papers to read. Okay, what's the intention of this? It's probably like paper search or something like that. So since it's not greet, I can't really add this example to the same intent label. I'm simply going to create a new intent, which I will call, it paper search. And provide the actual example of how the user would say that. Then let's take a look further. A chatbot asked what specific papers I would be interested in, at least the topic, and a user said about physics. So this is not greet, and this is not paper search. This is providing more information that an assistant could use. So that's why I have to create another intent for this type of example. Which I will call inform, just because it's just providing more information about physics. And also what we have to keep in mind is that if we have entities and if we want to extract entities, we have to label them as well in our training data. And the physics here is a type of paper that an assistant would look for. So I'm going to label this by adding square brackets around physics, the value of the entity, and then in the parentheses, providing the label of this entity. So what is overall label of the entity? So I will call it paper type. And here in other examples can be anything else. It can be mathematics, English, you know, whatever. It's still going to be extracted after training the model as paper type, and it's just going to have a different value. So then assistant finds a paper that it suggested and then asks if a user would like to get a link. Oops, sorry. And then a user says, sure, can you also tell me who are the authors of the paper? This is where we have this interesting thing of multi-intent, because here a user says and means two things. A user says, yes, please send me a link to the paper, but also a user wants to find out who are the authors of this paper. So an assistant has to understand that actually a user asked two things rather than just one. So again, since it's a new intent, that is a multi-intent, I will have to define it as a multi-intent. So the first intention of this input is sure, so affirming. That's why I will call it affirm. And second intention of this input is asking who is the author of the paper. So that's why I will add assign plus, saying that it's another intention of this input, and I will call it just authors. And again, just like in previous examples, I just simply use this example to train this specific intent. And then I have other things like a user said thanks and a user said goodbye. It should still work. Yeah, it really depends on your training data, but punctuation, I don't think it should have an impact on prediction. And then I have other examples like goodbye and thanks. So again, since I can't say that thanks belongs to any of these intents already, I have to make a new one. For example, intent thanks, and provide an example here, thanks, and so on. So this is one conversation. If you have more, and you ideally would want to have more, all you have to do is, again, to go through the conversation and just simply look what are the intentions of the inputs. For example, if I have another conversation starting with hello, what I do. So this is the intention greet. Again, we already have an intent for this implemented. I just simply add another training example. That's how it works. Now, of course, you need more than just one example for each intent, or more than five, because you know it's still machine learning, and all the same rules apply. If you have very little training data, you have such a big risk of overfitting and building not the very good model. So you need more examples like that. For each intent, at least I would say a good start is at least 10, 15 examples. So just to cut some time and not to spend an entire workshop generating training data, I'm going to use one of the files. Oh, I'm actually going to show you. Finding it. So in the repository, I have a file called nlu.nd. So this file has exactly that, a little bit more examples for each intent. I'm just going to copy and paste it in the cell here, just again, as I said, to cut some time, but all this data was generated exactly the same way as I showed. For example, for the multi intent, I added some additional ways of how a user could ask that. I also have a few additional intents. For example, if a user would say, no, I don't like the paper you suggested, find me something else, and so on. So great, we have some training data now. I'm going to just simply run the cell, and what it will do, it will write this file into this nlu.md file. Now, when you have some training data, the next step is to define the pipeline. Pipeline is the piece that is responsible for defining how the model is going to be trained. And it defines how the user inputs are going to be parsed, how the model features are going to be extracted, and what, at the end of the day, what model is going to be used to perform intent classification and entity extraction. So here I have already pre-made a configuration. I'm just going to explain what is happening. So language here is just for the reference, because again, we are not using any pre-trained vectors here. So it's just for the reference that our bot will speak in English. And it only depends on the training data. If you want to build assistant in Spanish, simply write your examples in Spanish. That's how it works. So the pipeline consists of these components. So tokenizer whitespace, it's simply a tokenizer. So when a model will see a white space in a sentence, it will know that this is the place where it should find the boundary of the word. NARCRF is a model that is used for entity extraction, so the conditional random field model that I mentioned previously. Featureizer count vectors is a component which creates sentence representation, so again, average, for example, of the vectors that are created. And then we use TensorFlow classifier. So this is that ranking model that I mentioned previously that allows you to build a model that understands multiple intents. And then, just like we had a question previously, we have to tell our model that we will have multi-intents in our model. And we do that by saying that if a model finds a multi-intent label, those labels should be tokenized, so that if I have an intent affirm plus authors, that it should be separated into two tokens and that they should be also trained separately. And then what symbol we used to define this multi-intent. Since we used plus sign, that's why I provide plus sign here. Again, this is really up to the developer to decide what components you want to use. Raza and Leo has a bunch of other possible models. It's something you can look up in the documentation, and you can either play around or look into the code and figure out which one you would like to use for your specific project. But it's quite simple configuration we are going to use today. So we have data, we have configuration. Let's train the model. So, first thing first, we have to load the data. So I'm going to simply call the function called loadData, which is inbuilt in Raza and LU, and I'm going to provide the file name that we saved our training examples in, which is called nlu.md. And then we have to initialize the trainer, so the class that is going to be responsible for actually running the training here. So Raza NLU comes with a train function, which will do that. And we have to load the configuration of the pipeline here so that it would know how to train the model. So it has a method called config, I think, load. And here we are loading the configuration file. So I think the configuration file was, yeah, exactly, saved as config.yaml file. config.yaml. And once we initialize the trainer, we can actually train the model. So then trainer will have a method called train, which is a function to actually train the model. And here what I'm going to do, I'm going to pass the training data file in. And also I would like to see the output of how the training works. So I will set verbose to true. So it just simply will print the results as the model is training. And the last thing that we can do is to set where we would like to save this model once it's trained, because we will want to use it later. So trainer, then the model, has a method called persist. And here we can specify the path where we would like to save the model. I will simply save it in models NLU so that it would be easy to find. And another component we can set if we want to is a fixed model for this NLU model. Because if we don't do that, Rasa NLU will generate a random number for the model. So if you retrain the model, it's going to be like a new model will be created. So by setting a fixed model, the same model will be overwritten. And it's just easier to find where the model is. But again, depends on your project. Sometimes you maybe want to have each model with a new name and so on. So I will set a fixed model name, which I will call current. Okay, I think that's all. Let's see what happens. Huh.
Trainer.
Yep, exactly. Very good. Yeah, so hopefully it's going to work now. Yeah, and you can see that each component that we defined in a pipeline is trained subsequently, and we should see some training results at some point. Yeah, so I think by default it is using 300 epochs, but it's some again, you can tune the models yourself and you can set the parameters for training yourself as well. So once the model is trained, it should be saved. Yeah, exactly. It is saved in the local directory. And now what we have to do is to actually see how it works. let's test it on actual user inputs. So here I'm going to use this pretty print function, which I should spell correctly. So pretty print. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to call interpreter, because this is how our NLU model is now going to be referenced. It will be called interpreter dot parse. So this parse method will parse the new input. So let's try on some messages. I will say maybe hello at first, see if that even works. It does. So this is the output of the model. What you get is the intent classification and entity extraction result. Intent, the first intent that you see here is this, the most probable intent that the model thinks should be assigned to this input. So here, the model thinks that a hello message is greeting with a confidence of 0.89%. And then you also get the confidences for all other intents you have in your training data. That's useful, and you can make use of it if you want to use some benchmarks, like when to say that a model is pretty bad, or when to set some kind of default response that if a confidence is lower than maybe 0.2, an assistant should respond with something, hey, I don't really understand what you're saying, and so on. So it's really useful information. Let's try something else as well. Let's test the intent about the authors of the paper, if that works. Again, we have a really small training data set, so that's I would expect some mistakes here. So again, it did assign intent authors here, didn't find any entities. Let's test something with entities. I will probably look for a paper. Say I'm looking for papers about machine learning. Let's see what we get. Oh, it worked. So it's it did assign intent label paper search, because I did search for papers here, asked for papers, and it found machine learning as an entity. So you can see it extracts this entity with a value machine learning, the label of this entity as paper type, because that's how I defined in the training data. And it also shows where in a sentence this entity is. So it's, these are the character numbers of where in the sentence this is. Great. So if you want, you can play around and ask test this on more inputs. But I'm going to move on from here, and I will show another way that is good to inspect the models, because again, it's machine learning, so you do want to know how the model is performing before you move on and use it later. So Razan, you have some evaluation functions that you can use to test the intent classification and the entity extraction. So for example, you can get a confusion matrix for intent classification. I'm not sure if you can see. So here, for example, you can see that greet and goodbye sometimes, once got mixed up, but and other things are pretty perfect. But it's because we have really, really tiny training data, and if you would have more intents, more examples, I would expect to see more mistakes here. So just a good way to test and see how your model is performing, apart from just manual checking. Yeah, and then you can also see the prediction confidence distribution. So, like, what percent? It doesn't look nice. Sorry for that. What is the distribution of confidences or predictions? And you also get a precision recall F score for each of these tests. So it's useful information if you want to test your model. Great. So at this point we have an LU model. Our assistant can understand some things that we want to ask. So I'm going to move on to the next stage of this workshop, which is dialogue management. And before we write some code, I'm actually going to explain something. Oh, nope, not this one. Yeah. So dialogue management and what is under the hood. Why would you even want to use machine learning and RASA Core for dialogue management when you can simply write some rules? If a user says this, and if the intention of the sentence was this specific thing, then a bot could respond with specific answer. So what is the matter with using machine learning instead of that? So in practice, and especially what I see when people want to build assistants that can run in production, state machines and rule-based approaches, they really don't scale. I'm not trying to say that you should never use rules or you should never use state machines. That's actually how I started with my journey in chatbots and conversational AI. And it's actually a really good way to prototype a bot and build something simple. But based on my own experience, when the assistant gets bigger, when you have more intentions that you want your assistant to understand, and when you add more and more actions that you want your assistant to run, a state machine becomes super complicated. And I had some personal experience with that. I realized that with state machines and with rules, I used to spend a lot more time debugging, going over the architecture of the assistant over and over again, trying to find where should I add one more rule for this specific thing that failed, instead of actually improving and developing the bot. So the main idea of using machine learning for dialogue management is that instead of predefining rules and then expecting a conversation to follow those rules, you actually take a completely different approach from the other side. You have conversations and you build a model that can approximate the turns of the dialogue. Another point is reinforcement learning. And actually, I think this is where it will go. I think it's a very valuable approach for conversational AI. But The challenges that come with reinforcement learning, at least these days, is that you need quite a lot of training data. You also need a good reward function, which is challenging to do. And the people need simple solutions. So with RASA core specifically, you can prototype something pretty quickly and pretty easily. You don't need huge amounts of training data to do that. So here again, why machine learning? One simple conversation can have so many different turns, and if a developer will have to sit down and write rules for each of them, that is going to be a pretty big job, especially, again, if you're building something that you plan to deploy in production and if it's something you expect millions of users to use. So here I actually have an example of quite simple bot that is was created with State Machine. And I'm pretty sure this is quite simple assistant. I think it can do only one or two tasks. And you can already see the architecture of this bot, which is quite complicated. So instead, as I mentioned, it's a more scalable way is to have conversational data and then build a model that can generalize on that and make predictions of how the assistant should respond. So how RASA core works under the hood? So NLU model is super important, and because it provides a lot of information about what the user said, and it's important because this is what the assistant will make a prediction on how to respond. So intents and entities that are extracted by from NLU model are combined with the current state of the conversation, so what the conversation is about at this specific moment. And the model also uses previous actions, so what the conversation was about a few steps before. You can also define how many steps you want your assistant to use for these predictions. And all this information is used to predict the next action, how an assistant should respond. You have a selection of models that you can use. Some of them are inbuilt in RASA core. Again, if you don't feel confident writing your own models, that's completely fine. And you can use SVM, which is a simple approach. You can use a recurrent neural network for that, which is a default model in RASA core. Because it needs to include the past and current state to make predictions. And then, once the action is predicted, it becomes the new updated state. And an assistant makes a prediction and executes the action that was predicted. So for example, to a question, what's the weather like tomorrow? A response could be, it will be sunny 20 degrees. And the assistant then uses that information, this response, to make predictions for the next steps as well. So again, it's a recurrent neural network, so as a default, so it uses something that happened at this specific moment and something that happened previously, so that an assistant could keep the context. And even deeper view, what is happening? So again, we have RASA NLU model with intents and entities that are extracted. We have a recurrent neural network here that takes all these details, so entity and intent as input. Also, if at that specific state of the conversation, assistant made some API calls or retrieved some data from the database, and if it retrieved really important information that could make impact on the prediction how the assistant should respond, these details are also used there. So for example, if you build a bot, for example, I don't know, to open a bank account, your assistant would need some details about the user. So it would ask, like, what's your name, what's your probably surname, and the other details. And if some of these details are not provided by the user, an assistant should know that they are not populated and that the assistant should ask them either in later stages of the conversation or immediately. So that's how it makes the details that are extracted, and that's how they make impact for the prediction of the action. Another thing that you might consider, it's not applied every time, You can use action mask. So if you're working in the industry you use some kind of, I don't know, sensitive data or some or you want to build a version of your assistant that is explicitly of different, let's say, levels of your assistant can be used for specific clients, but some other functionality is closed for other clients. So you can use action mask, which limits what actions an assistant can predict. If you do that, then of course at the end you have to renormalize the predictions so that they would sum to one, and all the actions, then again, predictions for all the actions would sum to one based on probability. You have action that is predicted, and this action again can be an API call or the response that is being sent to the user, so a simple text response, which can be just a message, it will be sunny and 20 degrees. This entire action prediction cycle, it can repeat multiple times. So it's not always like one input and one action from an assistant. It can be one input from the user, five actions from an assistant. Again, it really depends on what kind of dialogues you are trying to model. Cool. So it's time to code again. And let's see if we can build a dialogue management model now. Again, we are building a machine learning model. For machine learning model, we will need some training data. In Rasa Core, training data consists of actual conversations between a user and the assistant. The only thing that you have to do is to convert those conversations into a Rasa Core format. And this format consists of user inputs expressed as those intents and entities that you use for NLU model, and responses of a bot should be expressed as action name, so that when the specific action is predicted, an assistant would know that that specific piece of code should be ran to execute the action. So I'm going to reuse the same conversations that I had previously for NLU model, and I'm going to show you how the conversion works so that hopefully it becomes a bit more clear how this format looks like. So I will take, again, conversation 2 because it's easier to see. So the conversation starts with hi. And if you remember, we assigned the intent greet for hello messages. So here I'm just going to go step by step and write this down as a story in a Rasa format. So the conversation started with greet intent, and star means that this is user input here. Chatbot responded, hello, hi, I'm Paper Search Assistant, how can I help? This is a response from a chatbot, that's why I have to assign an action name to this response. And here I will call it utterance. Since it's saying hello back to the user, I will call it greet. I will explain later why I'm using utter, because we have some other actions a little bit later. Okay, so the next input was I'm looking for interesting papers to read. Again, the intent we assigned to this one, I think, was paper search. So user input, and here an assistant asked what papers are you interested in, so it asks for more information, so it can be, I can call it other paper type maybe, because an assistant asks for type of the paper. So a user provides details, it looks for papers about physics. So again, user input, we assigned inform intent for these type of inputs. And since we have an entity here, we should also include this in a model, because as I mentioned, details, when they are provided and when they are not, they might have impact for the predictions that the dialogue management model will make. So I will also do that by providing an entity. Paper type, I think that's how we called our entities for papers, and the value physics. Actual value here is not really not going to have an impact in this specific case on the prediction. It's just going to be important if this entity is provided or not at that specific state of the conversation. So then an assistant looked for paper, so it probably executed some action. Little disclaimer, it might maybe made an API call to look up some papers in some kind of database or something. So I will call it action paper search. And then it also asks, do you want to read this? I can send you a link. So it can be another action from the assistant. Let's say, let's call it utterance approve, where an assistant simply asks, do you want to read this paper? And then a user says, yes, sure, and also tell me who are the authors. So this is the multi-intent we had, which was, I think, if I remember correctly, it was a firm plus authors, and so on. And then an assistant sends a link, so it can be another utterance, and so on. So this is how it works. You take the conversation, you convert it into RASA story format, and you use this type of data to train the dialogue management model. Again, I don't want to spend my entire workshop on generating training data, because if you can think of other possible conversations, that's how the generation of training data would look like. So I'm going to take some help from myself that I did previously. I have a file in the repository called stories.md, and this file has a little more stories like that, so very similar to what I just wrote. And I think I have maybe 8 or 9 stories, like possible conversations that I came up with that an assistant could have. So for example, what can I show? A short one.
Can I have a question on the stories?
Yeah.
So you mentioned that you don't need to like specify all the possible entities that could go into that paper type. So mm-hmm. It seems like in the stories you have a bunch of different paper types. So you're saying it just recognizes that there's an entity there.
Yeah, exactly.
So generally, like, how well do these like paths generalize? Like, if
it really depends. It really depends on how complex your assistant is going to be. So the more actions you would like your assistant to be able to predict, the more training data you will need. So if it's something simple like we have here, like we have just one action or two actions that an assistant should make, then probably even 10 stories, possible conversations is a good start. But if you want to build something bigger with, 20 possible actions, then you should think of more examples.
Do we need to write every possible pathway?
No. It seems like there's... Yeah, no, exactly. So this is the power of machine learning. Of course, you need data to get started, and there is no way around it because that's machine learning. But a dialogue will start generalize after some time, after training the model, as well as NLU model. So you don't have to write every possible intent, like every possible way of saying something for intents. You don't have to list every single entity. Model will learn and it will start generalize. So that's the goal, to build a good model to make good predictions. So I have just a few examples. For example, with this one where a user said, hey, find me a paper about statistics, and an assistant suggested a paper, and the user said, no, I hate this paper, I hate this recommendation, probably an assistant will say something, okay, goodbye. So I'm running the cell. Again, I have just 9 conversations, so super small data set still. But let's go with it. So the next step is to define a domain. So this is where we tell our assistant what kind of environment is going to operate in. So it basically has to know what kind of things it should expect from the user. So here you have to list the intents you have in your training data, so just the labels that you included in the training data, as well as entities. So we had only one, which is paper search. Slots. I don't think I actually mentioned slots yet. So slots work as placeholders for important information that you would like your assistant to remember throughout the conversation. So for example, when I ask an assistant to recommend me a paper, and then if I want to ask some follow-up questions, for example, what is the author of the paper, or can you send me a link of the paper, or what year this paper was written, an assistant should keep those details in mind after it made an API call or retrieved this data. So this is one of the ways to tell an assistant that it should keep those details in memory and remember them. The same is with paper type. You can keep it as well so that a user wouldn't have to remind an assistant every single time with every single input what type of paper a user asked for at the beginning. And then the last bit of the environment of the assistant is a list of actions. So actions that, again, you had in your training stories, labels that an assistant should be able to predict. And here you can write the responses. Once specific action is predicted, you can tell an assistant how it should respond. Again, if you want to use NLG, you are free to do that. This is a simpler approach, just simply tell an assistant what kind of possible responses it could use. So for example, when a user said hello, and if action utter greet is predicted, it will use, for example, this message: hey, I'm a paper search assistant, how can I help? If you want to, you can provide more than one possible response, so you could probably write something, I don't know, hey, yeah, something like that. And then it will simply randomize and use more than one possible response. So this is the domain. Again, it consists of all intents and entities in your training data, actions, possible responses if you want to include them, and slots if you want to keep some information throughout the conversation. So the only thing that is actually left to do is to define a custom action. So that disclaimer I mentioned previously, API call. So when I ask for a specific paper, I do want assistant to go on the website, or on the web, sorry, and find that paper for me, the one that I asked. So here we can define a custom action for that. And custom action in Rasa Core is a class which consists of two functions. One of them is simply defines the name of this custom action, just exactly the same way as you have here, or the utterances. So when this action paper search will be predicted, an assistant will know that now it has to run everything that is in the second function called run. And this is why you can write the code of what an assistant should do then once this action is predicted. So here, we will tell an assistant to make an API call and look up the paper that I asked. I'm going to use an API provided by one of the Germany universities. They just basically have this API for paper search, exactly, so you can use different criteria, what type of paper you would like to find, or what authors, again, are, or when the paper was released. So since we have an entity, paper type, so an assistant should know what specific paper it should go and look for. And here, by specific, I mean the area, like, again, as I mentioned previously, machine learning or statistics and so on. And if a user provides this information, it's going to be set as a slot. And here we can retrieve that value. And in the Rasa Core tracker is responsible for keeping track of all the populated slots. And we can retrieve the value of specific slot if you want to. It's called getSlot. And here I can define the type of slot that I'm interested in. So it was paper type. So when I will say, hey, please find me a paper in about chatbots, let's say, and if the NLU model will extract chatbots as an entity, it will be populated as a slot, and then an assistant will be able to use this value of the slot to look for paper about chatbots. And that's exactly what it does here. So once I have paper type extracted, it is using to make the API call, then I just extract some additional details about the paper, like title, what is the author of the paper. So it's just, it returns me a JSON output, so I just extract some information that I think it will be useful for assistants to have. And now I can create a message that an assistant will send back to the user once it finds a paper. And in Rasa Core, there is a dispatcher that is responsible for sending messages. And there is a method called utter message. So it sends a message back to the user, and I can define what the message that could be. So I will, when an assistant finds a paper, I will define that it should say, I found a paper called, and I will use some of the details that an assistant found. So for example, I can use I will use, of course, title, because that's what it says. So format, and I will use title in here. Or you can use your own custom message, or you can There are, again, different things what you can do with custom actions. You can, retrieve a picture and send it back to the user. It doesn't really have to be a text response all the time. It's really up to your use case and what you want to do with your assistant. And then since I want to keep some of the details in the memory of the bot, I simply set link as a slot so that an assistant would remember what was the link of the specific paper and what is the author. Again, so it's really specific for this use case, but it's basically showing what it's capable of. Okay, so I'm saving the code here. I'm just triple checking any typos or anything like that. So before we go ahead and train the model, I want to show one thing, so this is the part where we use GraphViz, and if it doesn't work for you, I'm really sorry, but I hope it's going to work for me at least. So you can visualize your training data. And this is a good way to debug, again, and see what is happening in your data so that you can find some conversations and flows that you think will add noise to your training data and will make your model worse rather than better. So, for example, you can see that in my training examples, all conversations will start with greet, and an assistant probably would predict what the action called utter greet. And then here we have two different paths, how the conversation could go. One of them is when a user immediately says what type of paper they are looking for. Another one, when a user doesn't say what type of paper they are looking for, and you can see that then an assistant would ask a follow-up question what type of paper they are looking for. The user would provide that information, and it would be a paper search and so on. So I'm not going to go through entire tree here, but it's again, it's one of the ways to inspect your data and see what is happening so that you could debug your training data easier. And now we can go ahead and train the dialogue management model. I will run this to see if I didn't make any typos, because I sometimes do at this stage. So I will explain what is happening. So we are simply initializing our agent. So this is how we call the assistant. We provide the domain, the environment where this agent is going to operate in, and we define the policies. Policies define the models that are going to be used here. Keras policy is using an LSTM, the model that I mentioned previously, that includes current state of the conversation and everything that happened previously. And also we use training data that we defined. And here is an example of a very simple, actually, example of what you can do with customization in RASA Core. So you can tune the models again. You can change these parameters, and I have only a few. For example, you can define specific number of epochs you would like your model to use. You can also, as I mentioned previously, define how many steps an assistant should remember from previous conversations, so that it would have different impact on the predictions that it makes. And then again, we just save the model in local directory. And when the model is training, you can also see what type of model that is, what layers, if it's a neural network, what layers it is using, and also the results of the training. So the loss, the accuracy, so it's, again, one of the ways to inspect your model as you train it. Okay, it saved it. And now it's the most exciting part, probably, which is actually seeing how it works in action. So before we do that, we have to define custom action server, because that's how it works in RASA. So you have your agent, and all the custom actions, like all the API calls and so on, runs on different server, so that if you want to make changes on that end, you don't have to restart the entire agent all over again. So here I just simply defining the URL for the webhook that is going to use to run those custom actions on. We have to start the server. So here I will, if it won't work, I will use some Jupyter magic. I will start a command line inside the Jupyter. and I will run this function here, which will use RASA Core SDK, which is part of RASA Core, and it's simply going to start the action server, so that it would be ready to listen and ready to execute custom actions if they are predicted. By custom actions, again, I'm referring to this API call that I defined. And you can see it registered the function for action paper search, so that custom action that we defined. And it is running locally on this host and port. So when this is running, I think we are good to test. So what we do, load an LU model that we trained previously. This is where the model is saved, so I'm telling where that is. Also, the endpoint configuration, so this is the webhook that I defined just in the previous step. And also, I load the agent, so the dialog management model that I trained previously. And all this is just to make it work in Jupyter and print out the results. Let's see. Okay, that's exciting. So my bot is ready, it's loaded, and now I can test it. So let's see what is going to happen. So I will start simple. I will say hello. Yay. Hey, yeah. So it actually used one of those additional responses that I defined. So I will ask, I don't know, I am looking for papers about. I will use chatbots, because it's chatbots, the topic that I have. So it actually worked. It did make an API call, and it looked up a paper called response selection with topic clues and so on. So it actually did make an actual API call and got this result. So would you like to read this paper? I can send you a link. I will say, yeah, why not? So it sent me a link. Maybe I can even test it and to check if I actually found the paper it said it found. So it was about retrieval-based chatbots. Yeah, looks the same. So then a user, I think, can download the paper and read it if they want to. Hooray. Yeah, and then, I don't know, maybe I can ask some follow-up questions. So I have, in my training data, I had about the authors. So who are the authors? Let's see if that works. Okay, so here is a list of authors. Well, one, only one that it found, or that was returned by JSON, by the API call. So it gave me that. That's good. So, and then I can say thanks. Enjoy your reading. I can say goodbye. So this is kind of a happy path. Again, I can maybe try another one, maybe a little bit more complicated. Let's see what happens if I ask some multi-intention questions, if it's going to fail or not. So I'll start with hello again, how can I help? Looking for interesting to read. So I will not tell what kind of paper I'm looking for. Okay, it did predict that it should probably follow up with a question on that. So I will say about physics. Okay, it found paper with physics in it, in the title. That's great. Would I like to read it? Okay, I will try a multi-intent here. I really don't know what will happen. It might fail. I'll say yes. Also, can you tell me who are the authors of this paper? Let's see what happens. Oh, it actually worked. I'm actually surprised because we had so few training stories here. So it did send me a link, it did send me an author, so it did identify that this input was a multi-intent input. And then I can again say thanks or something like that. So this is how it works. But again, as I said, all models have limitations, and it's important to improve your models, especially using the feedback from actual users. So my suggestion, especially when you just start prototyping an assistant in general, is to give an assistant to real users as soon as you can, because it is going to be a lot easier to capture some training data. And also, again, speaking from my experience, if one developer spends his or her days generating training data, a very big chance is that this developer is going to develop and write quite biased data, and this is where I have some experience. So I built one model, one assistant myself, and I decided that I'm going to generate as much data as I can, and I'm going to give it to users only when it's perfect. I did that; it worked amazing. I gave it to one of my friends to try it out, and they said, "Well, it doesn't work at all. Like, it's not even responding to simple questions." I'm like, "How is it possible?" And then I checked my training data, and I saw that I actually kept very similar structure of my sentences for NLU model. Then I had very similar training stories for my bot, and so basically I built a bot for myself only. But then when I gave it to my colleagues to speak to a bot, I captured a lot of different conversations that I could then reuse and make the bot a lot better and generalize a lot better. So that's my suggestion. And another good way to improve your bot is by using user feedback. So I will probably skip this evaluation, but maybe I can actually just show what happens. So for dialogue management model, you can also see the evaluation of the model. Again, the same confusion matrices and so on. Is it going to even work? Does something. This is just a confusion matrix for dialogue management model. So back to user feedback. I will jump back quickly to my slides just to do a very quick, so how user feedback works in RazaCore, and this is the stage which is called interactive learning. It works in a way that when a user is speaking to a bot, or a developer is speaking to a bot, instead of actually executing actions that are predicted, a bot will tell a developer or a user what action it thinks it should run so that a user could tell if this is a correct action or not. If it is, that's great, a bot will continue and will take that information as correct. If not, it will also take that information and learn from the feedback of like what the user said a chatbot should have done instead. So yeah, so if a user is not happy with the response that an assistant made, a user is able to provide some feedback, and then the assistant will use that information to retrain the model using that feedback and improve. So back to code here. So I'm just going to do a demonstration of how this interactive learning works. So here I will also need console, again, Jupyter magic. and I'm going to run this function. What it does, it's going to start Raza core model in a online training mode. And you will see how that looks like. I'm just going to quickly retrain the model as well. It's not necessary. You can actually load a pre-trained model if you want and then continue improving that. But since we have a very, very similar one, a very small one, sorry, I will return 100 epochs. It shouldn't take long as well. Okay, so. So the UI is probably still for developers for now. Hopefully in the future it's going to grow to something that actual users can use as well. So how that works? So the conversation starts with user input. So that's what RazaCore expects. So I can start with, again, a message, hello. Now, an assistant, instead of predicting everything and taking action, is asking me, is the NLU classification for hello with intent greet, so this is what it predicted for this input, is it correct? And here I can say if it's correct or not. In this case, it is correct, so I'm just pressing Y. And then the bot proceeds, and of course it keeps track of what the user said and all that feedback that user provided. Then it also gives me all the chat history, what happened. So the conversation started with an assistant listening for user input. Then I said hello. I also get the confidence for this intent classification. It also tells me which slots are currently populated. I don't have any because it's just the very beginning of the conversation. And then, again, the next step, a bot asks me that it wants to run an action called utter greet, so it wants to say hello back to the user. Is it correct? Or like based on opinion of a developer, is it correct or not? I think that's pretty correct. So then an assistant responded with the same, hey, yeah. And then it asks again, a bot wants to run action listen, so it wants to listen to what happens next and what the user says next. So I think that's pretty correct because I will want to say something. So now I can provide another message. I would like to show an example where a bot fails. I don't know. I will do something. Can you order me a pizza? Completely out of scope of what my bot is about. So again, just an example to show you how that works. So it wanted to assign paper search. While it's not really like pizza and paper search doesn't really work well. So I would say no, it's not correct. You should do something different. And this is here, this is why I can say no, actually this prediction is wrong. And then NLU and this interactive learning mode gives me an option to see what other intents I could tell an assistant that it should have predicted. And I can see the confidences as well, what was the thought process of the system behind making specific predictions for each intent. And then I can assign something different instead. So I can say, for example, no, it should have been, since I don't have anything related to food in my domain, I don't know. Any, just for the sake of showing how that works. And then you can also mark any entities if you think the model failed extracting and so on. And then once you're happy, with the training, I think you can simply hit Control C. And this is where a few additional things come in handy. You can either continue online training and continue improving your assistant with this user feedback. You can get back to the previous stage if you thought maybe your choice was wrong and you wanted to assign different intent or different action at that specific state of the conversation to the user. You can start over if you think entire session was wrong that you did. Or you can export data that you generated using this interactive learning session. It's going to be added to your stories data if you have already some stories generated somewhere on your local machine, and you're going to finish the interactive learning session. So this interactive learning session is also a good way to generate some training data as well, because as I said, the conversation in a RASA training format is going to be exported and saved where you specify. You can even call it a different file. I can call it stories online MD. And it successfully wrote stories in a stories online MD file. So that's how it works. And okay, I still have a few minutes left, so I'm going to wrap things up. And here I have some tips, some of them I already mentioned. So you don't need to collect huge amounts of training data to get started. As I mentioned, you need some for the very basic version of your bot, but you can bootstrap quite a lot and build quite a reasonable assistant with very small data sets. But it's important to keep in mind that it's good to give an assistant to the user as soon as possible, because at the end of the day, users are going to be actual users of your assistant. And you can use this approach to get more training data and improve your bot with user feedback that you get. I also have some references, so RASA documentation. We have some tutorials that are looking into specific parts of this workshop that I showed you here. So if you're interested, check them out. And I'm going to wrap up with with just a few final thoughts. So as I mentioned, it's really important to close the loop again. You train your assistant, you train the models, it works great, but then you should have to keep in mind that your assistant has to be able to learn from user feedback, and this is the way it works. You get some new training data, especially if you can get actual training data between your assistant and the users. You make corrections if you need to make any corrections in that training data after you inspect and debug the stories, for example. You retrain the model, If you need, you might need to relabel collected data and use it to improve your model. Probably it looks like, you know, it works, it's all perfect, but to be honest, NLU and dialog management is far from being a solved problem. There are so many challenges out there that are still super difficult, that still needs a lot of attention. So for example, handling out of vocabulary words, and these days people come up with so many new words every single day, especially millennials. So you have to think of these problems as well. Also, multi-language entity recognition, how you build a model that can converse in more than one language at the same time, or how do you combine dialogue models? Because, well, it is quite easy to build a pretty decent dialogue model in a specific domain, but the challenge is how do you build an assistant that can do more than one thing, or that can generalize across a lot of different tasks. And also a big challenge is negation in NLU. How do you train the model that knows if you say, no, I don't want to do that, that an assistant would understand that it's actually negative rather than positive. But since, as I mentioned, Raza is really truly caring about AI and the conversational AI, we are really working a lot on improving our models. So some of them I already introduced, so like multi-intent and these pipelines that we believe are going to help developers to build better assistants and to make it easier. So this is just a summary of what I spent speaking about this an hour and a half about. A key is to get started with a small data set, start prototyping, and it's always better to think what is waiting ahead. So if you want to deploy your model in production in the future, you should think of methods that are going to scale. Approach I am proposing here is machine learning based approach. But of course, you also have to be mindful, and you have to really think about your use case. I'm not saying that you should never use rules. A combination of both probably is also a super good approach when you build a good model for generalization, but also if you see that some cases are super, super challenging, you can introduce some rules. Again, Raza is open source, so you can tweak everything there. That's it. So if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer. If you have any thoughts, suggestions, questions after the talk or after PyData, here are my email, my Twitter, and also join Raza community. It's open source, so we are super excited about people who want to contribute, who want to be part of conversational AI field, and help us push the boundaries of this field. So thank you very much.
We have a few minutes. Does anyone have any questions they'd like to ask?
It's a great talk. Thanks for sharing with us. So my question is about like the state management across sessions. So for example, does Raza handle something like that? So like you have the asking about physics, give me a paper.
Mm-hmm.
If you were to close that session, is there a way to save that information off so when you come back and say, hey, I'd like another paper, you don't have to go through the step where it says it's physics?
Yeah. So at this moment, there is nothing specifically that is implemented in Raza software, but you can definitely do that because you can retrieve all the details, as I showed, for example, using slots, so that everything that user mentioned, and you can, my suggestion would be store that information somewhere in a database or something, and then assign session number or user number or device number to that specific user, and then when the user comes back, just simply load all these details or add some kind of layer in your assistant that would look up those details and check if the user actually provided them and reuse them or ask again.
So saving it into slots, and then you don't have to change the architecture.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank you.
We have time for one or two more questions. Does anyone have any other questions you'd like to ask?
Yeah, thanks for walking through this. So it seems like there's a lot of work out there for like classifying certain intents or responding to certain intents, just like greetings and like time of day and stuff like that. How much work is there? Or how easy is it to integrate things from Raza? Because there's certain elements that Raza has that doesn't seem like Dialogflow or other things have. How
easy is it, or how much work is going around integrating Rasa with something like Dialogflow or with Lex, or like having those two things kind of like work together?
So based on my experience, I would say it's not really that difficult. So one of the things that I did personally myself, I integrated Rasa into a Google Assistant. So I just wanted to see how I can make a Google Assistant more conversational, to ask follow-up questions and so on. So it really depends on how flexible is the framework you want to integrate, because with Rasa, as I said, you can customize everything. If you don't like NLU, you can replace NLU part with something else. If you don't like dialogue, you don't like model, you can replace with something else. You can write things on top of that. I would say it's really not difficult, but it depends on what kind of framework you want to integrate that with. If another framework is also flexible, for example, Google Assistant is generous that you can actually use your own NLU and they don't have any tricky UIs that you have to go around, so then that's easy. Yeah. If you have something specifically in mind, we can chat about it and I can see if I work on something like that.
Any other questions? We have time for one more. All right, Justina Petrtita, everyone.